Good morning, PSUP. Today is Friday, November 19th. I'm Audrey.
And I'm Bradley.
Here with your announcements.
Congratulations to the PSUP Marching Band as they finished out a tremendous season at the Bands of American Grand Nationals Championships in Indianapolis, Indiana this past weekend. The band was named a national semifinalist amongst 99 bands from all over the country. In addition to this honor, the PSUP Marching Band won several competitions over the course of the season and was named one of the top bands in the state of Michigan.
Student Run Credit Union will be at Salem today during all lunches. All students who have accounts and savings will be entered to win a free sweatshirt from their homeschool store. Now on to Jonathan with your news bit.
Hi PSUP, I'm Jonathan. And this past weekend, I went to downtown Plymouth to check out the Penn Theater to find out what it has to offer this holiday season. Come with me to learn more.
Guys, I'm here with Ellen Elliott, and she's the director of the Friends of Penn. So, can you tell me about some history about the Penn?
Well, the Penn Theater was actually built in 1941, so we're coming up on our 80th anniversary and just next month. And so the Penn was built exclusively as a movie theater, and that was kind of different at that time because movies were just starting to come to really make it big. And so in Plymouth, there were two theaters, and this was the first one that was actually built at the time as exclusively as a movie theater.
Could you tell me a little bit about the layout of the Penn? How many theaters you guys have?
Okay, so the Penn Theater, because it was built in 41, is just like any other theater that was built then. It has a single auditorium, and we have no plans of changing that. It will stay as a single auditorium. We have a concession area, which when they first built the Penn, it didn't have that. So you would come and there was no popcorn, there was no pop. You just basically came and sat down and watched the movie, and then that kind of evolved over time. And now we have a full concession stand. So basically you walk in, you're at the concession stand, you're in the inner lobby, and then you're in the auditorium. So there's really not much to the layout of the theater. It's very simple, it's very straightforward.
All right. So you guys have been around for about 90 years, right?
Nope, we're celebrating our 80th anniversary.
80 years.
Yep, so the Penn was privately owned, and it closed. The thing you have to keep in mind is as TV came in, as other things came in to compete with movies, VHS tapes, which I think you guys are old enough to know what those are, DVDs, those things came in to compete with the movies, it became very difficult to run a single screen movie house to run it for movies, right? So it got very expensive, and so the owners sold, and it looked as if we were gonna lose this historic building. And the building itself represents Art Deco age. Art Moderne is the style. And so to lose this building for our town would have been disastrous. So we actually formed a nonprofit group called Friends of the Penn, that was in 2005. And by 2006, we had been able to start showing movies again. And so we've been operational for over 15 years and have renovated and updated. And because, when it was privately owned, it was very expensive. So they couldn't keep up with maintenance. The roof was leaking. There was so much that was wrong with the building. But because we were able to raise money through donations, because we're a nonprofit organization, we were able to do that with the community support to bring it up to what it is now.
Okay. So since you guys have been around for so long, could you tell me what you guys' secret formula is for staying alive amidst, imagine opening up? I know a local theater in Canton shut down, as well as COVID.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so what's key for the Penn Theater is its history. So I grew up in Plymouth. I came here as a kid, my kids as well. So that type of thing is something that the other places don't have. And it's really critical to engage the community. So the community has a stake in this. So, we have donors that have donated to help us do our job, to help us keep this place open and running. And they're from all over the country. So people that lived here and they moved away, it's still close to their heart. So they want to keep it here. They want to come back and experience it. So the donations that we've received have helped us stay open all that time. Through COVID, we had tremendous support from all over the country to help keep it alive. So it really is different. This represents what a movie theater really should look like and what it used to look like. But I think what happens as time goes on, we get where we expect certain amenities. But this is the simplest form of watching a movie that you can see without all the bells and whistles. The fact of the matter is we get people that come every week and they don't even care what the movie is. They just want to experience this way to see a movie. It's right downtown, so you can park your car and you can go and eat dinner, walk across, and enjoy the park. There's really, the big places don't have it. They're in the middle of a parking lot, right? They don't really have this ambiance that we have, the history that we have. So those types of things are what keeps us relevant, keeps us alive, and is the community engagement is of the utmost importance. So if you were to come see a movie here, and you come often enough, I'm gonna learn your name. And then you're gonna come in and I'm gonna say, oh, Jonathan, hello, how are you today? And then, so that type of thing, you don't see at the other places like you do here. And so we'll have people that are, older, they live alone, they don't have anybody. This is their only exposure to people maybe for the whole week, right? So we engage them in conversation. We inquire about their families. We truly care about our patrons. And that's, I think, what makes the difference, that we're not just out for the money grab. We're out here to provide a safe place for people to come, that they enjoy coming to, that doesn't cost an arm and a leg, and that they feel comfortable and they feel welcome. So Janice is an artist who's local, and she's done things in all over the town. People commission her. She's done paintings for Mike Illich, Bush's grocery store, all different. She's been commissioned to paint everywhere. So she's very, very talented. And some of these you see, there's connections to Plymouth in most of these. And if you know Plymouth, you'll know what they are. Like this right here, it says Fred Hill. Fred Hill is a local businessman who used to have a men's clothing store across the way. So that's representative of him right here. Concourse to Elegance, that is a car show that comes every July. Over here, this is this is what's on top of City Hall. So there's different things like that, like the Grand Torino. He's actually holding a Red Ryder BB gun. So each painting kind of has a Plymouth connection that she painted in it.
So in the future, do you think there will be plans of renovation or expansion?
We will never expand. We don't have the space to expand. We're kind of landlocked where we are. Our goal, so we're actually in a historic district. So we're part of the historic district, which means we can't change the outside of the building. We can change inside, but our goal is to keep it as authentic as we can, because as places are being torn down, there's nothing that represents certain time periods once buildings are torn down. So our goal is to really keep it as authentic as we can, making sure that it's clean, making sure that it's usable, making sure that it's comfortable. And if we can do that, we feel like we will have attained our goal of preserving the Penn Theater for years to come.
So where can people come experience the Penn?
We're at 760 Penniman Avenue, which is right across the street from Kellogg Park in downtown Plymouth. You can check out our website, which is penntheater.com, for all of our upcoming movie showings. And we welcome volunteers 14 and over. So if people want to come and help us out, they can do that. And all that information is on our website. So, yep.
Well, I'm Jonathan McKay, and this has been the Penn Theater.
Thanks, Jonathan. The class of 2025 Student Council at Plymouth is looking for new members. The meetings are once or twice a month on Tuesdays from 2:30 to 3:15. Every Plymouth High School freshman is welcome. Please reach out to Mr. Hoffman in the counseling office or just attend this week's meeting on Tuesday at 2:30 p.m. in room 400.
The SAD Club is meeting Tuesday at 7 a.m. in Plymouth, room 612. We hope to see you there.
Plymouth wrestling season begins this week. Practices are from 4 to 6 in the Plymouth Wrestling Room. Plymouth Wrestling is still looking to add boys and girls of all grades and sizes to their team. If you're interested, email Coach Pat. Now to Brady at the pool with your sports.
Thanks, Bradley. What's up, Peace Up? I'm Brady here at the pool with your sports. This weekend is the state meet for the Plymouth girls swim team at the Holland Aquatic Center. The record this season was 3-4, and they placed 9th at the conferences. Brady Kendall is Plymouth's individual state qualifier, but they qualified for the 200 medley and 200 and 400 freestyle relays as a team. Brady is a 2-time defending state champion in the 50 freestyle and 100 butterfly. Brady, how does it feel going to the state meet as a 2-time state champion?
It feels pretty good. I'm definitely super excited for this meet, and I'm kind of a little nervous, but I think I'm ready for the meet, and the competition is just, it's going to be a good meet and a good race both days.
How does the team feel going into this meet?
The team's feeling pretty good. We've been training all season for this meet, and we think it's going to go pretty well. We're all a little nervous, but it's going to end really well, we think.
What was your most challenging meet this season?
All right, so in my opinion, our most challenging meet was definitely conferences. So at the time, we were supposed to have a bus, but there was a little miscommunication, so we were unable to ride the bus. So a few of us had to drive. It was a bit of a hassle at first, but I'm really proud of this team for overcoming that.
Another pretty challenging meet that we had was our Canton meet, because I know a lot of us were sick. But we all pushed through really well and did really well as well at the meet.
What is your best memory of the season?
We had a lot of good memories this season. It's a really, really fun team. We had a lot of fun. Definitely beating Canton would be at the top of the list. I just remember they're announcing the score and they go like 90, like Plymouth 96, Canton 90, and it's silent for a minute as we all like process it, and it just stack erupted and we were all like screaming and jumping around and crying, and it was awesome.
How did you guys train throughout the season in preparation for states?
Throughout the season, we've been training in the beginning, trying to build muscle, working on more of our sprint and distance, just trying to get yardage in. And recently, in the past week or so, based off of our level, we've gone to taper, kind of taking it easy, focusing on technique when walking into state meet.
For states, what are you guys most excited about?
I think we're all most excited to just cheer and see what this team is capable of at states.
Alex, how does it feel to be the first girl state diver in Plymouth history to make it to states?
I'm honestly pretty nervous, but I'm super excited to go.
Okay, I'm going to ask that one question we all want to know. What is the best conditioner to save chlorine-damaged hair?
That's a great question. I think Malibu conditioner is great for your hair.
Thank you, ladies, and good luck this weekend. For professional sports this week, for the 11th week of football, the Windless Lions go head-to-head with the Browns on Sunday at 1 p.m. For college football, Michigan State will play Ohio State on Saturday at 12 p.m. And Michigan will be going up against Maryland on Saturday at 3:30 p.m. For professional basketball, the Pistons will be going up against the Lakers on Sunday at 6 p.m. Lastly, for your sports, the Detroit Red Wings will be playing against the Coyotes on Saturday at 8 p.m. Now back to Bradley and Audrey with your announcements.
Thanks, Brady. Salem Wrestling is looking for more wrestlers at all weight classes to join this historic team. Any Salem students interested in joining the defending district champions should contact Coach Pete Israel through the Salem Athletic Department website. Season begins on November 15th. All wrestlers are welcome.
The Salem, Canton, and Plymouth Student Councils are partnering with PBJ Outreach to host a canned food drive. Please don't forget to bring your canned foods to your advisory class by Tuesday, November 23rd.
A hat and glove drive is being held until December 3rd. Please bring gently used or new hats and gloves to your advisory class. The group that brings in the most items will receive a donut breakfast. Now on to Grace with your weather.
Good morning, PSEP. I'm Grace here with today's weather. Today will be a warmer day with a high of 45 degrees and a low of 28. No clouds today. There will be sunshine all day. Enjoy the sun, PSEP. Now back to Audrey and Bradley with your announcements.
Thanks, Grace. The Environmental Club would like to thank everyone who helped with the creek cleanup last week. They got pounds of refuse out of the creek and have created a more pleasant environment for the animals that live there. Thanks for helping clean up our campus, PSEP.
We have a special behind-the-scenes tour of the Michigan Thanksgiving Parade Company.
Hi, everyone. My name is Lena Carter, and I am here at the Michigan Thanksgiving Parade Company. The Michigan Thanksgiving Day Parade was founded in 1924 and has been a one-of-a-kind spectacle of fantasy, holiday spirit, and community enthusiasm ever since. Detroit's first Thanksgiving parade featured horses pulling a float decorated with Mother Goose, 4 papier-mâché heads, and 7 marching bands. Today, the parade has more than 75 units, including floats, balloons, and marching bands. The Michigan Thanksgiving Parade Foundation was founded in 1982 for the purpose of staging and perpetuating the Thanksgiving Parade. I am here with the President, CEO, and Executive Director of the Parade Company, Tony Michaels. Come with us to learn more about the parade's fascinating history, exploring the 200,000 square foot storyland of floats, and see how award-winning artisans bring them to life. How are you doing today?
Doing great. How are you?
I'm doing very good. Thank you.
Good.
Can you tell us about any of the new floats or units this year?
Absolutely. America's Thanksgiving Parade, presented by Gardner White, has 5 brand new floats. Central Michigan University for the first time ever. General Motors is back in the parade. Delta Dental with a brand new float, and Henry Ford Health Systems with a new float, along with the Skillman Foundation, where a student of Detroit Public Schools actually designs the float and we build it right here at the parade company.
Oh, that's amazing. How many floats are in the parade?
This year there'll be 26 floats in the parade. There'll be 60 units total in the 2-hour parade, and it'll be viewed by close to 1 million people on Woodward Avenue, and the television audience will do close to a 25 rating and a 45 share, which is massive.
Can you tell us a little bit about what the designing or like making phase of a float looks like?
Absolutely. We meet with the various corporations and we listen to what they have to say about the messages that they would like to send in their design. We then think tank here at the Parade Company. We put something on paper with pencil, drawings with our artists, and then go back to them, and then they cast their opinion. They make changes. They love it. They hate it. And ultimately, going back and forth probably 3 or 4 times, we have a final design that we then hand to our sculptors and our builders right here in the Parade Company studio, and you have a float about 3 months later.
Do you have a favorite float?
I like every float. I really do. There's so many great ones. You look at the Jazz Fest float, the Gardner White float, General Motors, Huntington Bank, I mean, Blue Cross, they're all great. They really are, and they're all unique to themselves. You know, they all have the messaging and they're creative. They are wonderful, and I love them all.
What would you say you enjoy most about being the CEO of this parade company?
I think the smiles on Woodward Avenue on Thanksgiving morning, the kids, many of the kids, this is their one entertainment piece for the entire year. Others are more fortunate, but everybody is smiling. Everyone is enjoying it. They get to see Calvin Johnson, you know, this year, our Grand Marshal. I mean, think about that, Hall of Fame NFL player, all the great floats. So I enjoy the faces and the joy.
What is the hardest part about your job?
The hardest part of the job is the logistics. There's a lot going on, and we have a great team, just a wonderful team. But to piece this all together, it takes a year. We have to sell all the sponsorships. We have to build the floats. The floats are for 3 years, each contract. But it is a logistical challenge. It really is. And that's probably one of the more difficult parts, but we get it done.
How many volunteers would you say you have at the parade?
There are close to 2,000 volunteers that work with the parade company for the year. Remember, we not only do the parade, but we do the Ford fireworks, the S3 turkey trot, and Hobnobble Gobble. So there's a lot going on, and we've got a lot of great people out there who donate their time and help us out.
So good to hear. If someone wants to volunteer in this parade, how would they go about that?
They would go to theparade.org and pop right into volunteers and find out about it. And please volunteer. We love our volunteers. We really do.
I just want to say thank you so much for having us here at the Parade Company, and I'm really excited to watch the parade.
Well, that's great, and thank you for coming here.
Thank you for coming with us to explore the sights and sounds of the Michigan Parade Company. This year's Thanksgiving Day Parade kicks off at the corner of Kirby and Woodward at 8:45 on Thanksgiving morning with the live broadcast on WDIV Local 4 at 10 a.m. Make sure you tune in to see the historic parade.
That's all for your announcements. Peace up. Have a good one. For real, this time.